Thank you for showing up here. I'm Gopinath Langote. I've been working as a software engineer at N26. We are based in Berlin. We have a couple of offices in New York, Barcelona. Basically, we are building a digital bank. Today's talk is about confidently releasing microservices with consumer-driven contracts. I know there are too many buzzwords here, so let me set up some vocabulary around these words. The first one comes is confidently. What confidence in this context means is going to production with the confidence that nothing will break. Having hundreds of microservices, changing one microservices with small bit and pushing it to production, having the confidence that not other 99 microservices will not fail or any existing functionality will not fail is the confidence here. Second is releasing. This is an ability to go into production. In short, we can say it as a continuous delivery, right? So how confident I am to go to production, or how is the ability of team to go to one service to the production? This is what releasing means here. Microservices, as you might be aware about this, having multiple components, multiple individual units of pieces combined as a one product and going to your production. That is what microservices in short. Consumer driven. Imagine a very classical problem of client server architecture, where client being your consumer of data served by, or pages served by your server, right? So in other way we can call it as a provider. This is going to be our new vocabulary for next of our remaining 40 minutes is consumer being who consumes your API or who consumes the data, the service which are consumes the data, and the provider being who actually provides the API or the data to other services. Contracts, I mean any other contracts we write, like for our house contract, right? So the contracts are commonly understood way of saying something. For example, there is a client and there is a server. Client understand that, okay, my browser is old way and I cannot understand its mobile device. I cannot understand the big screen. Just give me in a short screen way. And the server should respond with that specification. Or any other way, for example, a service having, let's say I am having a payment service and I need data from a user service and I expect that it should return me, say, name, email ID, and blah blah, right? So in some specific format, that is what a contract means here. As we have now vocabulary set up, I will walk you through the classical problem that I have faced in one of my projects and how we solved that using contract testing. The little bit about the problem statement was, there used to be an account service and there is a service called user service. Of course, we being having 200 plus microservices in our organization and more than 20 agile teams, these two microservices were owned by different teams. Account service is owned by payments team and the user service was based owned by growth team. And account service used to, the primary specification for account service was to generate some your monthly account statement, your bank account statement, or weekly, you know. In that matter, account service used to create some PDF format file. For that, you need to also print the user's data so that you can understand this transaction arts by users. To do that, account service used to call to user service, hey, this is the API/users/ give me the details of user one. And in return, user service used to return ID, username, and user email ID. And everything was working fine, everything in production, all those two services are compatible with each other, and everything was working in production. What happened is the genius developer like me thought of doing some refactoring. What I thought is, why should I return username or user email ID? Though I know this API is only for users, why should I write user always as a redundant prefix? Why can't I just return ID, name, and email ID? Because I know I'm returning user's data, right? So I did refactoring, and on what happened is you can see that in GIF, what I thought of will not happen, but everything broke. As we had a couple of our test pyramid ready in our existing organization, having, you might be aware about this traditional test pyramid, having unit test at lower level, then mock integration test, mocking your other service and behaving like the other service, and then on top of that a functional service, functional test, which sometimes people call it as a system integration test, where all those services and front end, back ends coming together and working as a one application, and you are running test on that, or sometimes people call it as a behavioral testing. And the last is, of course, the QA engineers manually testing your features. we had all of this, and let's see how where we caught our problem of this particular refactoring. Talking about unit test, as everyone you know, it's just method level. You are just testing a method behavior, maybe some branches, not even aware about more than your one single class, maybe a multiple class, but not aware about the other service, right? So having account service, I'm writing an integration test for it, which calls to user service. And in that integration test, I am assuming that the class level unit test is not aware about user service at all, right? We are just mocking classes. So that way, unit test is never going to catch this problem of service to service communication. So for us, for this problem, this is not trustworthy to trust. Then we had second level of test, which is like a mock integration test, wherein a use account service used to write an integration test, and not rather than using actual user service, mocking the user service with some mock server, right? So how we usually write integration test, such integration test, we set a first expectation saying that, hey, whenever there is a request for user one, return me with this. And you write actual test saying that, okay, call this URL, you call the URL, you actually go to your mock server, not the user service, and then mock server as expected will return you the same response and you validate the response, all green, right? But the problem with this was, the user service was mocked. User service was not real, right? So user service will, the changes in user service, this account service is not aware about, right? Even though integration test was in place, account service is not aware about this refactoring, and this integration test was not trustworthy for us. Why? Because there is no feedback loop happening here. There is account service in isolation is not aware about the user service changes. That was the problem happening here. Apart from just checking the JSON structure and the serialization, deserialization part, this integration test was not more than that. And then next level of test was a functional test, wherein all the services up, front end, back end, everything, and your behavioral user journey started doing, right? You actually, user go login on your website, click on download account statement, you download the file, and file will have your name. And that was your whole integration test. And definitely this functional test is going to take a lot of time because it needs all the services to be up and running with all the new versions, and then you are testing it. Of course, it come at the top of your test pyramid is going to take time, but end of the day, it was trustworthy. It caught our problem, right? I mean, actually, the service someone changing like me did refactoring and caught this problem in a functional test, and definitely running functional test is going to take a lot of time because functional test comes after your all the pipeline goes green, and then your last stage you run the functional test and then go to some higher environment, right? So it was taking longer feedback loop. We can see user service changes, small changes, account service got to know about it in a long way after while running functional test. At the same time, functional tests are going to take a lot of time. Should I write functional test for each service to service communication? Let's say there is no API, there is no public feature I'm launching, it's just an internal service to service communication, and there is no front facing application that we sometimes write, and should I write functional test for it? If I'm started writing functional test for each single communication happening between service to service, having 200 plus microservices is going to take days to run this functional test, right? And of course the feedback loop will be much longer. But end of the day, it was trustworthy. We found the problem. And the last was, of course, manual test. I mean, we are engineers, we are humans, right? We can make mistake and we can just ignore this small test to run. At the same time, if there is a single change in API, should the QA engineer sit and do manual test on each commit going to production? No, right? So the problem in the whole picture was having feedback loop at very longer time. Some users, some service changing some APIs, other service are getting to know about it way longer after going to production, right? So that was the problem which is happening. What we wanted to have is no service should go to production without complying other services. For example, I'm a provider service, it's a user service, or let's say authentication service, which commonly is the pattern that people use. And let's say authentication service change their API saying that, okay, if the rather than 403, I'm going to return in some cases 4x, right? Say 402 or 401. In that case, authentication service will just go to production and other service are not aware about it. To make other service aware, it's going to take a lot of time. When the other service trying to go to production, that time you will understand, okay, functional tests are not working and it's going to fail. So it was longer feedback loop. And then we came to know about this term called contract testing, which is sometimes people call as the microservices testing. Or T-reading microservices in other hand. So where this contract testing fits in? Like when so as functional test was already solving our problem, and unit test is not we are expecting to solve a problem. The contract test testing itself will fits in somewhere in your mock integration test where you are doing, which is little heavier than your unit test. It's just not aware about just one class or one method. It's more than that. But at the same time, it's little less than functional test because it's not aware about all 200 microservices. It's just aware about me and the service I'm communicating to, not more than that. So that's why this fits in somewhere in contract test, the level. So which is the first problem got solved of having longer feedback loop, and the second was having no service should go to production without complying with other, and how that will get solved, we'll look at into it. At high level, contract testing itself, the paradigm itself can be divided into two parts. One being consumer creating contracts. In our case, account service saying that I need ID, I need user email ID, I need username, not just name and email ID. And I'll write some common format file saying that this is my contract. And the provider, you should be compliant with this before changing any API of you, right? So this is account service and user service and the contract between this. The contract can be written in any commonly understood framework, like for example, XML, JSON, YAML, anything that the two services can understand can be written in that same contract. How the structure of your consumer contract test looks like is you have a test. It's exactly similar as your mock integration test, just on top of a few things. First, you register expectation, hey, whenever there is a request for user 1 with the detail, please respond me with this particular JSON or this particular payload. And you actually hit the request, and rather than the request going to your actual user service, it goes to your mock server, which is like kind of intelligent enough and return back you the same what you expected. Apart from this, as mock integration test used to do the same, it also generates some file. Whatever you are interacting with this mock server, this generates a file. We call it as a contract. After you do interaction, like account service was expecting some details, it expected some detail like username and user element ID, it created a file and goes to production. When there is a provider service, which is a user service, which wakes up and now tries to satisfy all the contract between each one of the consumer. In our case, there was only one consumer. Till this point, account service created just one contract and goes to production. Nothing happened, everything green goes green, right? Next time, something like me changed the code and did refactoring and tries to push to production. That time, one of your CI/CD pipeline, what you do is you take all the contracts of user service, like user service, who all are dependent on user service. Take all the contract and execute them against it, saying that, okay, my current build satisfy all the contract that my consumer have. Okay, all green, go to production. But in our case, I did refactoring, it will fail, right? So in that condition, your consumer is independently going to production, no dependency on production, no dependency on your provider service, and just creating one contract and going to production. At the same time, independently, your provider service need not to worry about your contract. When there is a changes in your provider service, it will just complying with all the contract. All the contract satisfies, which means service to service communication is good and I can go to production, right? So in this case,
So who maintains the contract? Is it this provider or the service consumer?
It's good. I am going to come to that part, which in short, both needs to coordinately store somewhere, and both needs to know that these are the contracts where I stored. So these are the two main flow of your contract testing paradigm. One being creating contract, going to production, no worry. Second being, okay, I am the provider. There are a couple of consumers who has contract with me. Let me satisfy them. If satisfies, go to production, otherwise no. So in this way, both services can independently go to production, just satisfying their consumers, right? So one of the service, we just talks to one service, other service, I don't need to write the functional test for it and wait for hours to run, right? Only these two services independently can go to production, which just take maybe seconds, I would say, to just test, and I can go to production. This is how, in short, this contract test paradigm looks like. Let me walk you through the small code, and then I'll demo it, how it looks like in actual coding. I'm using Java, you might be familiar with. If not, no worries, I'll just walk you through this. The tool I'm using for this contract testing is called PAT, which is one of the de facto standard of industry currently. What I'm doing is the first step, as I said in last slide, is three steps: registering expectation, requesting, and your response. The first one is I'm just creating a mock server so that rather than actual user service, my mock server will behave as a user service. And this is how I'm just creating it, just like new pack provider behave as a user service. And the target is this is just for the test tool I'm using, that is JUnit. The second thing is setting up expectation. Actually, if I call you user one, what should I get in response? So if you can see that, if I can create a body here, I'm expecting ID, I'm expecting username, and I'm expecting user email ID, not just name and email ID, right? And if I can see the builder, if you just read it, it's very straightforward that, okay, builder, upon receiving a request for a user with the path // with method get, and it should respond me with the headers, which is like application JSON as a content type, status should be 200, and body should be the body I expected, and just two pack. And this way, you're just creating some expectation on your mock server, which behaves as a user service. And the last is, as like normal, you write a test, you have a gateway, rather than in the gateway, if you see here, rather than using actual user service host and port, I'm using mock servers host and port. And I'm just calling gateway.getUser of ID 1. I'm expecting some users should be 1, ID 1, username should be Bob, and user ID should be me@gmail.com. And assert equals that whatever I expected my mock server to respond me, and this is actual, should exact match. This is how in the three step what we can write the test for. Maybe let's make our hand dirty with the code. Can you see it? I'll just walk you through. I have two services here. Let's see, your account service and a user service. If I go to user service, I have a controller here which is a Spring Boot application. Upon asking for an ID, it just returned me statically as of now with bob@gmail.com, a new user. If you see here, user has ID, username, and user email ID, right? So it was the old way of specification. And this is my controller looks like. And at the same time, if I go to account service, and there is a user service gateway, upon asking for a get user ID 1, it just generates some URL and just make the HTTP request and get the response, and using some Jackson to deserialize. And at the same time, on a account service also, which is our consumer, which expect the specification as ID, username, and user email ID, right? So both look same. So let's look at a contract test, how it looks like. So as this might be the answer to your question, saying that where this contract should lie, where should I keep? As of now, I'm just debugging it on my local machine, so I'm just keeping at some file directory or system file directory in my machine as of now, but this can be stored in S3 or cloud storage also. I'll come about it in bit later. And in this line, I'm just creating a mock server which is behaves as a user service. I'm creating some expectation about account service talking to user service with a request, a path, a method, and will respond with whatever specification I have specified. And the last part is your actual test, which I'm creating a user service gateway class with rather than using a user service host and port, I'm using my mock server's host and port. I'm just calling the get user and expecting the user and expected user should be same. Let's run this test. Apart from just going green, because everything I set up it, right? It's nothing, no other services in the picture. Apart from it, it just generate a contract for you. If I go down here, if you see here the folder I have specified, it just generate the contract for me. So this is the JSON contract which any service can understand easily, and the content looks like very straightforward, saying that okay, who is the provider? User service is the provider. Consumer is account service. What all interaction between these services? As of now, I have only one interaction. The first interaction is a request for a user. I mean, this can be a feature for your API also, right? Or get statement, get account statement. How the request specification look like is, this is the path and the method is get. And what should my server respond with the status 200, with the header content type application JSON, and the body, if you can see here, a user email ID, ID, and username. Now this is the contract that I have generated, the account service generated. Now provider needs to be compliant with this in order to go to production, right? And there are some metadata which is the tool specific, which need not to be same for other tool that you are using, which currently the tool I am using, which just capture the specification that I'm using. For example, the packed specification I'm using 3.0, and which JVM library I'm using is that one, right? So I have generated a contract now. And now the second parts come. Now account service generated a contract, go all green, go to production, right? Now actual refactoring came, and now we are trying to do verification against the consumer. The second part of it, which gets the contract from your consumer and verify against your current build, all goes green, go to production, otherwise no, right? So how it looks like? I'm using Gradle tool to just do verification, need not to write extra code for it. As you can see here, which is very straightforward, which the pack tool I'm using, who all are the service providers here. In my whole organization, only one service provider, let's say as of now, which is user service. How I can contact user service is using HTTP. What are the host, which currently I'm using localhost. It can be your pre-production environment, which can be your production environment in that matter, if it is read-only data. What is the port I'm talking to, and what is the base path of my service. User service has packed, which has contract with other services, in our case only one, which is account service. And where I can find this contract is this directory, the directory that I have stored the contract in. Now this can be a S3 location like Amazon S3 or Microsoft Azure, some cloud location, or a SFTP server, any of this, right? This is how simply it looks like. And now that as we have created contract, now let's run those contract against our I'm currently running this contract against my local machine. This can be happened using your pre-production environment or production or staging environment, right? So I'm just running my application locally so that I can run all the contracts locally. Application is up and running, and if you can see here, it's just a Gradle command saying that Gradle W user service is my service, and just verify the pact that I have with all my consumers. It just takes the contracts from this location that you have shared, the files that you have. If there is no contracts happen, it just goes ahead, right? As you can see here, log, it's very straightforward, saying that verifying a pact between account service and user service, where I found the pact is in this file. What was the specification? A request was there for a user which responded with 200 status codes which matched, headers matched, okay, matching body, okay, everything goes green, both services in production now. Now the actual parts, like the developer like me, did refactoring. Let's do refactoring and let's see how it catches the whole flow. Let me go to the controller which I have, which uses this user. Now let me change this to, let's say, just name, right, as we have said, and user email ID to just email ID, right? Now let's go here. Now I did refactoring, right? So now let's run the new build of my application, and I'm trying to run my whole application, and it should fail now, right? This is the user service with the new API which respond with just name and email ID. And now my account service is not aware about this change, and still expect that the older way of contract exists, right? Now let's run the pact verification one more time, which we have changed the now contract. And now this should definitely fail because I'm expecting some else JSON, you're responding with mail JSON. If you can see here, it shows me here, body status matched 200, okay, headers matched, okay, but the body matching failed. Why failed? Because there were some differences, minus being someone thing I was expecting but not happened, which is like user email ID, username not matched, but instead of that I got email and name, which I'm not expecting, right? So this is how your contract stays changed. Now team can decide what to do with this. Now maybe if the current circumstance, you can say that, hey, user service, please do not go with this API to production because we are breaking, we don't have time to implement this, or just implement one more version of your API and make your API backward compatible. Other way around, account service also said that, okay, this makes sense. Of course, I mean, username, user email ID is redundant, name and email ID makes sense to us also, and let us do also changes, which we are going to do it right now, and let's see everything goes green, right? So this is gateway, I'm expecting a user, and let me change the user I'm expecting to a name now. And let's change our contract test also, right? So we were expecting a username and user email ID, let's make it email ID only. right? Now let's generate a new contract which satisfies the new way of specification that we agreed upon, both the teams agreed upon. And if I look at this JSON now, all things are same as previous. Only thing changed is the body that we had both agreed upon, that hey, makes sense, name and email ID makes sense to us also, which looks good. Now let's go try to go to production, right? Because user service up and running with new specification, client also changed the new specification and all goes green, right? So now with this way, if you see, both services can independently go to production just having some contract between them, right? And this contract can be generated and verified independently. If, for example, there is a all contracts all green, rather than provider service changing, let's say consumer service thought of, okay, I'm not expecting this JSON from you, I'm expecting some else JSON which user service is not aware about, and trying to change the contract. When trying to go to production, user service will say, hey, no, this contract doesn't exist because there is no API like this exist. If you want to change contract, let us know, we will develop this API, we will give this API to you. So this both services can, both agile teams in other way can understand, and depending upon the problem, they can, either service can come back or other service can go up and just make each one of them compatible with each other. So this is how your end feedback loop is completing, right? And without knowing, apart from these services, two services, no other 98 services are aware about this, right? So and similarly, there are hundreds of thousands of call going on between each services. They can independently run their contracts and they are not aware about all what's happening in other world, which is good, which is not happening in your functional test. But if you remember in the contract that I was expecting something like this, user email ID, ID, or username, or for that matter just name and email ID, which is a static data, right? me@gmail.com. But let's say account service expecting some user one should have this data. How come user service will aware about that there exists a user one, right? So I mean, someone needs to create this data in order to get this from API, right? So this is what we call as a provider state. In this contract testing, consumer can say that, okay, before running my this contract, make sure, for example, in our particular case, before requesting for a user one, make sure that there exists a user one. And this is how we set up a contract provider state. As I'm using the Gradle tool previously, I can use the same thing and I can say that, okay, I want to change the status of your service to have user one. And what is the URL? Is this is the URL and this is the body. Just create one user for me. After creating user one and then request for it, all goes green. This is what we call it as a provider state, which is a very common pattern in contract testing. So this is at like very small level, local machine, everything goes green, right? What are the challenges that we have faced last 3 years I'm doing this tool, I'm doing this contract testing, and what all challenges that I have faced in my teams and how we overcome about that? What are the paradigm to choose, which to choose over what, that we'll talk about in a bit. The first one is a contract test. I mean, how should I write the contract test? Like, I use the Java as of now, but what are the paradigms there? What should I use for that? What tool I use for that? One of my project, we used to write a test as a source code. As you write unit test, as you write mock integration test, same way we used to write the contract test, like what I wrote currently in my demo is source code as your source code, and write a contract test for it. With this, everything was going good because we had only 10-15 microservices in one of our project, which was okay. But then later our organization grown and we had a couple of teams now, where QA engineers used to see it differently, not with the development team, and QA engineers sometimes used to write contract tests. And they said that, okay, we developers have their own choice and using multiple languages to write code. At the same time, QA engineers said that, hey, we can't write code in that much languages. So is there any way that we can satisfy? We still want to write a contract test, but is there any way that we can do it? So that way, we decided to write a contract test as part of different repository and different language, where QA engineers and developers both can understand, rather than using your source code as a contract testing source of truth. That way, we got a flexibility of your working teams. QA engineers can independently write tests, independently work, can work. With the older way, they used to know about all the codes that developers are writing. And every single change, developer changing, we used to communicate to QA engineers, hey, we changed this, can you change the contract test, and blah, blah, blah. So So this way we came up with the other option that, okay, why can't we write the contract as a separate code, separate repository. In this, what extra thing we have to do is we have to actually call to the service, right? It's just the source code of your gateway needs to be overridden. That was the only bit that we used to write twice, which was okay with the given organization structure we had. So this was one of the lessons that we had. Second was, as you mentioned, how to share these files. Of course, the local machine is not going to scale, right? It's a big team, big organization. So local sharing is not going to work. And then we came to know that cloud storage, why can't we store on S3, Amazon S3? And we started doing this on Amazon S3. Over the time, 200 plus microservices, each service to other service, let's say 10 calls, which is like a 2000 calls, and 2000 files on S3 constantly getting updated. There are versioning over API, like thousands of files on S3. And each time we have to get all the files, filter one of them just to between these two services was taking too much time, right? 200 services keeping same file, same location. And if I want to know the files between these two services, I have to filter all those, go through all 2000 file and filter only these files, right? This was taking too much time. So that what we thought of, rather the community thought of, to come up with something called as a broker. What broker means is something which is intelligent to keep your file along with some metadata and some capability to you. What it do in nutshell is the problems that we had with cloud storage, one being if there are 2000 or thousands of files or lakhs of file, we don't care, because broker is intelligent, is backed up by some persistent system, and if knows that, okay, service A to service B, give me all files, it knows the where these files are and just will return you those files, which is intelligent enough. Second, what about if I run against A service to B service and it failed? Where should I capture this? Where should I keep all the result of which service is compatible with which service? Previously, we used to keep it in some XML report, you know, documenting and all those stuff. Versus contract broker started giving this feature of, you can just see matrix of service A is compatible with service B or not. It's easy to visualize all your 200 microservices, which service is compatible with what service. Third benefit of contract brokers is your versioning. Sometimes people write version A of your API, right? GitHub, if you say Facebook, these organization, right? If you say version V1, V2, V3 of your API, right? So how to maintain this API? I want to test service A with service B with only version 2.0, not less than that, not more than that. Maybe version 3.0 is a testing version and they are just testing some feature. I don't want to test against that. I just want to test exact same version, which is not possible with the cloud storage, because cloud storage is just a dumb file storage, and that intelligent logic I have to write on top of it, which is a common logic. And that's why this contract broker started giving this feature of versioning thing. And the last being is, can I deploy? How can I be sure that service A is a provider and there are 10 microservices which are dependent upon A, are all the services are compatible with this or not, right? So can I deploy service A having 10 microservices dependent upon this? Can I deploy this? And I can just ask broker on my CI pipeline, hey, service A version 2.0, I want to deploy, can I deploy? And what can I deploy will do is run your against current build to all your consumers and says that, okay, you can deploy, or no, 8 of your microservices are good, but 2 of them are not, please make sure they are good with you, right? So this is what contract brokers come up with. And the last one, and is a bit tricky, is your verification. Where I verify this? Now we have generated a file, we stored it somewhere, and where to test it, where to verify it? The first was just write a like consumer test, just write a normal Java code or your language code to test this file, get from some URL, take the file, hit your URL and check that everything works. I mean, of course, if you have only few microservices, it can scale. At the same time, if you have big microservices, too many microservices, too many teams, it's not going to scale. And that's why, of course, you have to use some external tools, like something that I use, Gradle, which is language agnostic and which need not to worry about your code or your services. And this way, your infrastructure engineers or your system engineers or your QA engineers can write this script to test it. So which means it's not dependent upon developer or some repository or your source code. And the last bit and very important bit is, where should I put it in on your CI/CD pipeline, right? Where should I put it in continuous integration? the first option we did was running against my current build. Every single build going to production used to test this verification. And the later we realize, okay, this service is not changing that so frequently the API, but changing some background thing, which in that case I need not to run against my existing build. I mean every single build, let's say I am just testing some API, I need not to run all those stuff in my current build, right? So that's why we decided to run against stable build, which is like UAT pre-production environment, which was working fine. Couple of tools available there in market about this. One is PACT, which is like a kind of de facto industry standard. If you just Google it, contract testing, you'll just get the PACT. Why? Because it has all the language implementation, it has specification, you can implement in your own language, all good, good documentation. Of course, if you want to have your different ecosystem, like you, everything is in Spring Boot in your ecosystem, you can go with Spring Cloud, which is a good tool I would suggest for you if you are using Java or Spring ecosystem. And there are a couple of like Janus, which is like Clojure if you are using Pacto, which is like started by ThoughtWorks, which is one of the pioneer project of this type contract testing, which later Pacto said that okay, we are migrating to Pact and we are not no more maintaining it. And VCR for a Ruby, if you are a Ruby programmer, you can go with Ruby or VCR as a tool. If you are still not convinced with why to use contract testing or at all Pact, you can definitely go to this page, which is pact.io and FAQ convince me, which is definitely they will convince you with all the possible options in the industry and why the contract testing is so important. If you want to go look at some resources, my code, whatever I've shown you, is available on GitHub, which is like Pact GV implementation. There is a Kotlin implementation that I already pushed there. The Pact itself, their main website, which has good documentation about this contract testing. And if you might follow, if you are following with Martin follower, he had a couple of articles around microservices testing and which are, you know, easy to start and very good resources to start with. That leads to if any questions. Functional, definitely. I mean, we used to write each service to service call, we used to have functional test, which used to take 2-3 hours to run, right? And then we started doing this service to service call, and then we end up writing only functional test only for user journeys. Okay, only if user tried to download something, okay, that is the real testing. Not the, if one service call goes to 10 microservices, I'm not going to write a functional test for it.
This pretty much covered all your backend.
All the backend infrastructure. We are in the phase of writing front end to back end also, which is also going to solve our most of the problem. We are in the phase of that also. Yeah.
Now we usually plan to have within a sprint, let's say we want to have design whatever testing. Mm-hmm. Isn't this adding an overhead with respect to the time frame of considering the boundary of a sprint?
I mean it's a paradigm you have to choose. Waiting for functional test to run for 3 hours versus some writing some mechanism for 1 hour and getting it then ready. I mean, you have to choose it. At the same time, for us, once you have your infrastructure ready with this, what we have to write is one more test, and that's it. That is the more extra benefit, that is the one more extra efforts you are putting, not more than that. But putting up some infrastructure is going to take some time. Definitely yes, but time wise yes. I mean, a user journey, we have to write user journey test for a lot of these cases, which used to take less time to write test, but used to take a lot of time to run it. At the other hand, in contract testing, we have to write lot of tests because each service is calling to other service, thousands of contract testing, right? Maintenance is big, but at the same time, the running, the feedback loop is faster. Ability to go into production is faster, right? In the other way, functional testing, writing is easy. It was easy, but running was too much. It used to take hours. If I go to production, which I have to wait for 3 hours to run my all functional tests. In this case, it will take little time to write contract tests, but going to production is easy. The loop is fast. Yeah.
You gave us an example wherein the contract as in like the attribute that it was expecting, like username and mm-hmm. Started putting in a string into it.
Mm-hmm.
So will that contract testing identify or will be able to do that?
Definitely. I mean, if I'm writing here as a body, if you see string value, I can say string matcher, and I can say this regex should match. It should be int. I can say int type. I can say boolean. I can say anything. I mean, it depends upon the tool, which how mature the tool is. But yeah, of course, all the tools have this basic functionality. Yes.
In your scenario, I mean, the consumer wrote the contract first. So let's say my user service has been consumed by many other services, and I have a specific format, and different consumers want in a particular format, but I can't do that, right? My service is specific. So how would you handle that scenario?
It's little different paradigm. We use versioning in for that condition. Definitely we face this problem that couple of services used to have some different format they used to expect, wherein Google also do this this different way of responding things. We did it using versioning, and the tool that the broker used to help us. Okay, among 10 consumers, 8 of them use V1, just run the packed verification against this 8 of these and do the V2 against these 2, and the versioning helps us.
So you will have multiple contract files.
Contract file, definitely, for different version, yes.
Can we have like one single contract for multiple consumers?
One single
contract for one provider can
have a like... I mean, you can, but it's a paradigm that you have to change, whether you want to do it, because each consumer needs to get some isolation and their woven way of writing contract. Tomorrow, if they say one service said that, okay, I want in different format, I mean, do I need to change all of 9 of others, right? No, right? So it's a different paradigm that you have to change. Let's say, for example, in our case, user service, which definitely not going to change contract for one service. In that case, I can just write one contract. But in the specification, like as he mentioned, where each service want their own versioning, one way of getting response, in that case, this might not scale.
Depends on whether you want to build a contract as a monolithic contract or a service-based contract.
Yeah.
I'm using some third-party services.
That's the best question actually. I mean, we do use third-party services more than like 20, 30 third-party services, and we ensure that we write the contract test for them also. And we again test them their UAT environment. We ask, first of all, can you also write the contract test for us? Right? If they are consuming our API, we also ask them to, if you can write the contract test for us, that's the best part. If not, then we write on our side. Right. That has to be differently. I mean, user journeys we definitely cannot ignore with the consumer contract testing.
How it will reduce that effort put for functional test? That will remain same,
right? You cannot write functional test for each single integration happening between services, right? A functional test can be just one happy path, may not be a bad path. How about bad paths? How about corner cases? How about API returning 4x? How about API returning 500? Sometimes we also write, how about API returning 4xx, 5xx, right? How my service will behave in that case. So which is not possible in functional test, which is possible, which is going to take a lot of time definitely. That's it. Thank you.